Turn with me to Scriptures to the book of Matthew, the 6th chapter. And I'd like to look with you at verses 7 through 13, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. But when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This morning I'd like to talk to you a little bit about prayer. And I'd like to focus in simply on the first phrase of the Lord's Prayer, Our Father in heaven. One of the peculiarities of church custom is that this prayer has come to be known by anyone and everyone as the Lord's Prayer. And yet, that's an odd title because it is a prayer that Jesus never prayed and never could pray. Why? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. This is a prayer for sinners. Not for the Holy One of God to pray. Secondly, it's a corporate prayer, not an individual prayer. It is our Father, our debts. Deliver us from evil or evil one, and so forth. It would be better had we, as a custom, titled this the church's prayer rather than the Lord's Prayer. You know, John 17 has an example of the Lord's praying. But this is not for the Lord to pray. This is Jesus to pray. This is for us to pray. In this manner, you, plural, pray. Our Father in heaven. So having corrected that little mislabel that's so much a part of our whole heritage, from now on, I know you all call this the church's prayer and not the Lord's Prayer. Yeah, right. Not going to happen. Even in the church where I'm associate pastor, it's still in the bulletin as the Lord's Prayer. But I want you for a moment to think how overwhelming that first phrase would have been for the disciples when they heard it. Almost shocking. Because it's so much part of our custom to use the Lord's Prayer and to know it. And of course, even in some Reformed traditions, we know there's an uncomfortableness with corporate prayer said in unison, and some church traditions choose not even to ever use the Lord's Prayer as a corporate public prayer. But leaving all that aside, how do you address God? And we have a multitude of examples of the address to God throughout the Old Testament scriptures, most prominently in the book of Psalms that we regularly sing here. Now, the idea that Yahweh is God to Israel is not a concept wholly missing from the Old Testament. It is there in the Exodus account, in which God says to Moses to say to Pharaoh, let my son go, where my son, my firstborn, is a reference to the people of Israel. And Hosea quotes and uses that same language, where God's people are called my son in Hosea chapter 11. And likewise, we find in the promise to David that to David's son, God will says, I will be a father to him and he will be a son to me. So the notion of God as father is not absent from the Old Testament. It is there theologically. but it is not there liturgically. If you were an ancient Jew and you grew up with the Psalter, singing it, viewing it as in effect the prayers of the assembly of Israel, you would address God as Yahweh by his name, or by one of the common descriptions of God, God as our rock or our help, my God. We find all of those expressions, and many of them in the Psalms have an intimacy to them. But what you do not find in the language of the Old Covenant liturgy, in the language of the Psalter, is the common, ordinary address to God as Father. And so, you see, although the Lord's Prayer, as we label it, is familiar, we take it for granted, what must have it sounded like in the ears of the 12 when Jesus said, and you therefore pray in this manner, Our Father. This is a wholly new, wholly completely new way to address God liturgically. Not conceptually new, but as a form of address to God, it has an intimacy that nothing in the Old Testament liturgical material expresses. Here we have the people of God saying to God, Father, our Father. And of course, it is precisely the coming of God, the Son in human flesh, in which he establishes this pattern of saying to God, Father. Imagine how lacking your prayer life would be if in those hard points of life, in those difficult places in life, when you cry out to God in desperation, you had not yet learned to call God Father. You would still call out to him. You would say, My God, my help, my strength, my rock. But what's new with Jesus is this instruction to call God Father. And I want you just for a moment to focus on that substantial change in terminology. Terminology that we are so accustomed to, we don't notice it. And yet it is profoundly there. Not the notion of God as Father is absent from the Old Covenant, but the address to God as Father is not commonplace as it is in the New Covenant. So what does that mean? It means when we gather together as the people of God and we join our voices as one voice and we say, Our Father, we are saying something more than that we are the people of God. We are saying that we are the children of God, that we are the family of God. Do you feel that intimacy in the language? And the question I have to ask you then as we think about that is that true of your relationship to God, our Creator and Redeemer? I don't mean do you use the term Father, I know you do. Right? Professor York began his prayer with the term Father. It is customary. Perhaps you're in a church tradition, as I am, where the Lord's Prayer is said in unison by the congregation every Sunday. It's customary, but do you feel its force in your soul? And does it reflect how you relate to God? That God is not simply creator, ruler, judge, and sustainer. He's not simply the one who assures that you have an existence beyond this life and that you will not die forever in the pains of hell, but that he invites you into that most intimate of relationship of child to parent, of son to father. And you are to call him above all else, Father. Let me take you to one last text in Matthew. Turn with me to chapter 28 of Matthew. Again, in a text that we know so well that its familiarity itself can be an impediment to pay attention to what it says. Verse 19 of chapter 28. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. At the risk of perhaps being reprimanded for what I'm about to say, I want to suggest to you that at the level of liturgy, the Old Covenant name of God, Yahweh, is here supplanted by the New Covenant meaning of that name, Father. Let me suggest to you that the Old Covenant name, Yahweh, which, again, we don't use it ordinarily except in a context like this. We substitute the English word Lord as a Septuagint, substitute the Greek word Kurios for the divine name. And as the Jews in the synagogues are accustomed to substitute the Hebrew word for Lord in place of the divine name, that part of the newness of the new covenant is that liturgically speaking, we move from the abstract and philosophical name of God, Yahweh, to the personal and intimate name of God, Father. All that Yahweh, the name, is in Father. Nothing is lost. Nothing is given away. But there is now this intimacy of expression. To which I ask you then the question, if the name of God in the new covenant is preeminently Father, and if the prayer of the people of God to Yahweh is now in the form of not Yahweh our God, but simply our Father, does that express the intimacy of your relationship to your Heavenly Father? Or is it just the custom of words that we use because it's our custom, and its intimacy, its meaning, and its force is lost to us? Ought we not to delight in knowing that in the most difficult times of life, when we need to cry out to the Almighty Creator, the self-existent one, Yahweh, that we cry out to him appropriately with all the forms of address refined in the Old Covenant, but supremely with that form of address that Jesus teaches us to use that catches up all of those Old Covenant meanings and advances them one step further. And we say to God, Father. And isn't that remarkably good news? Amen. That sinners like you and me call on the Almighty and we simply say to him, Father, in a legitimate way, presuming on his love and mercy and forgiveness. In a legitimate way. This is to say, we don't start with the assumption that, well, maybe God will have mercy on us. Maybe God will let us come somewhat near to him. No, no, no. We know that in Jesus Christ, the Almighty has become our loving Heavenly Father. And we can rightly presume on that relationship when we call out to him, that he is Father. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Father, we thank you that your Son has taught us to call you as he called you, Father. We thank you that in that name we have the assurance of the forgiveness of our sins and our adoption as your beloved children and the certain title to life with you forever. We thank you that that title is of address is earned for us by the perfect obedience and sacrifice of your Son in our place. We ask, O Father, that we would not just use those words flippantly and without meaning, but that we would reflect and we would intend to always walk in intimacy of trusting, relying, and calling upon you as our Heavenly Father. We ask this through your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen. 131. 131A.